Hello everyone and welcome to today's webinar, Advanced NK Cell Research Solutions. I am Jennifer Woods of LabRoots and I'll be your moderator for today's event. Today's educational web seminar is presented by LabRoots and brought to you by Miltenyi Biotech. To learn more, visit miltenybiotech.com. We encourage you to participate today by submitting any questions you may have during the presentation. To do so, simply type them into the Ask a Question box and click Send. We'll answer as many questions as we have time for at the end of the presentation. You may also submit any technical issues here as well if you have trouble seeing or hearing the presentation. I'd like to now welcome our speaker, Julia Hengst, Product Manager, Miltenyi Biotech. Julia, you may now begin your presentation.
Welcome everybody to today's webinar about advanced NK cell research solutions at Miltenyi Biotech. My name is Julia Hengst and today I'm going to guide you through our variety of methods to isolate and analyze NK cells and to perform killing assays. For deeper and more extensive information, please visit our website and contact your local sales organization. So here, just as a short overview of the agenda. So I'm going to start with an introduction about where Miltenyi Biotech comes from and which products we offer by today. Then I'm going to talk in detail about how you can isolate your NK cells with different cell separation approaches. And then I'm going to focus on how to culture, activate and expand NK cells. And finally, finish with focusing on flow cytometry-based analysis, on the one hand, NK cell phenotyping, but also functional readouts, including killing assays. And then I will finish with a summary. And first of all, as short introduction, I want to talk about Miltenyi Biotech and where it comes from. So it was founded in 1989 by Stefan Miltenyi. So the company is more than 30 years old. And the basis of the MUX cell isolation is the Callum technology, which was developed as part of his diploma thesis and patented in 1990. Already in the beginning stages, Stefan Miltenyi had a pioneering spirit and saw the potential for MUX technology to become a revolutionizer in the field of gene therapy. The developments went on for over 20 years, including setting up of a GMP manufacturing site in Teterow, Germany, and getting FDA approval for the Clinimax CD34 reagent system. Now in 2021, the company has grown and has more than 3,500 employees worldwide, with almost a quarter of all employees working in R&D, engineering and clinical development, and over 46,000 scientific publications citing MUX technology. In addition, annually, more than 6,000 patients get treated with cell products that were isolated using Miltenyi Biotech technologies. So to enable an easy transition from research, which you can see here in the upper row, to the clinical applications, we offer, for example, microbeads, medium and cytokines, as well as the instruments as research grade, but also as GMP grade. So Miltenyi has many years of experience in the field of cellular therapy, and also we're now especially looking at NK cells. There are clinical trials going on. So just citing some publications where NK cells were isolated with the Clinimax Plus and used for the treatment of different malignancies. This shows the importance of translational NK cell research, also with regards to the developments and research focusing on CAR NK cells, where also research and clinical trials are increasing. So now regarding the first agenda point focusing on the technical parts, I'm going to talk about the ways of how you can isolate NK cells. So first of all, to highlight possible challenges that you might encounter or that you might fear when thinking about isolating NK cells from PBMCs. So this might be that you are afraid of activating your NK cells during this process, that you that the cell separation leads to low numbers of NK cells that you recover, that there is an NK T cell contamination, and that the isolation of NK cells is time intensive and that you cannot automate this process. However, now when looking at the possible strategies that we offer, there are two ways to do this. So it's a positive magnetic isolation or the untouched isolation. And most of you know Miltony Biotech from the MUX technology, so the magnetic separation of cell subsets. And now I'm going to talk about the difference of these two, and also in addition to this, looking at whether you start from PBMCs, so meaning that you first perform a density gradient centrifugation, where we offer for the positive isolation microbeads, in this case when looking at NK cells, the CD56 microbeads, either the standard ones that you probably know, or the Rialis CD56 microbeads that you can remove after the cell isolation. And also there are untouched isolation kits, which is the NK cell isolation kit, and which I also wanted to mention here, the ILC2 isolation kit. However, in contrast to this, it's also possible to directly start to isolate your NK cells from the starting material. This could be either whole blood, Buffy coat, Leukopak, or LIC, and which is shown here. For the positive isolation, there are the straight from CD56 microbeads, and for the untouched isolation, the new MUX Express, which can be used either for whole blood, Buffy coat, or LRSC. Now, when looking at into in more detail, you can see that when using here as an example the untouched isolation, the NK cell isolation kit, and on the other hand the straight from CD56 microbeads binding to the CD56 positive cells, you can see on the first hand that due to the fact that you isolate all cells that express CD56, that you also enrich for NKT cells. However, what I want to highlight and emphasize on this slide is that independent of which separation strategy you choose, whether you label all the cells that you're not interested in or whether you label the NK cells, that there is no activation of the NK cells as there is no no increased expression of CD69 nor of CD25. So there is no difference between the untouched isolation kit and the positive isolation. And when then also looking at the functionality of the NK cells after cell isolation, you can see here a comparison of the straight from CD56 microbeads, which were used for whole blood sample, of the NK cell isolation kit, so the untouched approach, so isolation of NK cells after PBMC isolation, and the MUX Express, so looking at the NK cells directly isolated in an untouched manner from whole blood. And here direct killing was analyzed, so killing of the cell line K562. And you can see here that there's no major difference between these three cell separation approaches. And also when looking at antibody-dependent cellular cytotoxicity, you can also not see a difference between the different approaches. So on the first figure here, between the straight form, so the positive isolation approach as compared to the NK cell isolation kit, what you see is rather the difference between the different E to T, so the effector to target cell ratios, that having an effector to target cell ratio of 5:1 leads to a higher specific target cell killing as compared to an E to T ratio of 1:1. But there's no major difference between the different kits used to isolate the NK cells. And the same is shown here, where you in contrast compared or see the data comparing the NK cell isolation kit untouched from PBMCs and the untouched isolation approach from whole blood. Also, there's no difference between the two kits, meaning that even though you have NKT cells also in the orange sample here, due to the fact that it was a straight from CD56 microbeads that were used for the cell separation, you do not see any interference with the assay, and meaning that the NKT cells do not, interfere or hampen the assay. And also, just to mention, NKT cells usually express low amounts of CD16, and in this case, the ADCC was performed using Raji cells and rituximab, so binding to CD20. Then the final approach that I want to focus on today is the re-ELISE. So in addition to the normal microbeads, there are also the CD56 re-ELISE microbeads. And when using these, you start off as usual, meaning that you label your target cells. In this case, you have PBMCs as well, and label the NK cells with the CD56 microbeads. Then you do your separation via the column, meaning that all the unlabeled and non-target cells flow through. And then in the next step, you elute the NK cells from the column with a specific buffer, which then leads to a removal of the microbeads from the target cells. In a second step, with another buffer, you can also remove the label, so not only the microbeads but also the label. And then upon that, if you are interested in that, there's a second magnetic labeling possible, either again with re-ELISE microbeads or with the common MUX microbeads. And I'm mentioning this because, for example, the labeling with after this with, for example, CD3 microbeads can be efficiently used to then deplete the NKT cells. Or other markers, such, for example, if you're interested in smaller NK cell subsets, for example, markers like HEAR or NKG2A or C could be used to further analyze or to further isolate these NK cells. Just here an example for the staining when using the re-ELISE CD56 microbeads. You can see here the plot for the cells before the separation, meaning that you can see here the T cells and the NK cells, and then after the enrichment with CD56, where you can nicely see the NKT and the NK cell population. And when you then, as just mentioned on the slide before, add or do a second separation with CD3 microbeads, you can nicely deplete the NKT cells. And what you're probably also interested in is how the cells look like after this separation steps and also removal steps. And thus, here there is a CD25 versus CD69 staining shown at all these three separation steps, and you can nicely see that before separation, after CD56 enrichment, and after additional CD3 depletion, the NK cells do not express neither CD25 nor CD69. So the NK cells are not activated upon these two separations. And yeah, just to mention again, the cells are ready for either subset magnetic sorting or also, dependent on how big the subset you are interested in is, it also flow sorting can be done as a second step. So just very, very briefly to end the chapter of the cell isolation is that there are two ways or two instruments which can help you to automate the cell isolation. This is on the one hand the Multimax Cell 24 Separator Plus, which can support a semi-automated cell separation, meaning that there are some manual steps. However, what it can ease up with is that here into this block, 1 to 24 samples can be separated in one run, and it can be used with the normal manual columns or also with a multi-24 column block. And thus, this is really helpful in case you have lots of small samples or one large volume sample, such as buffy coats or leukopaks. And just to highlight, there's also an application note which you can find on our website describing how NK cells were isolated with the straight from microbeads and the untouched approach, so the NK cell isolation kit as comparison, and together with the Multimax 24, and where you can then also see staining for activation markers and also see that independent of the approach, again, only the E:T ratio is affecting the target cell killing. So if you want to have more details for this, you can find these online or just get back to your local sales representative. And then, just very briefly, as second instrument, there is the Automax Pro separator, which can do the cell separation fully automated, meaning that it performs auto-labeling, so it can add the microbeads to the samples, then after incubation, separate the samples. Up to six samples can be separated in one run. And just one point that I want to highlight is that this instrument is using a reusable column and can be used for up to 2 weeks. This might be of interest for users that do a lot of cell separations. With this, I just want to wrap up the part of cell separation, coming back to all the challenges that I mentioned at the beginning that you might encounter. And that I, for the first point of cell activation, showed you in various cases that the cells upon untouched and positive isolation do not upregulate CD25 and CD69 and thus are not activated. That dependent on what starting material and starting cell number you use, you should choose the best kit for that approach, and maybe also try to skip the density gradient centrifugation to increase your recovery. Then, one step further, I could show that the NK T cell contamination, at least with regards to ADCC, does not interfere with the assay, as the CD16 expression is very low, and otherwise there are strategies to deplete the CD3 cells, possibly by a second cell separation. Also that the cell isolation is sometimes very time consuming. However, with the direct isolation strategies, with the straight from microbeads and Max Express, you can save a lot of time by skipping the density gradient centrifugation. And also it's possible to automate with these two instruments where I just showed very briefly the highlights. So to sum up, either when interested in isolating your NK cells directly from blood products, there are positive and untouched isolation approaches that are supported, and also you can start off from your PBMCs and isolate your NK cells with a positive isolation or the untouched isolation. So with this, I'm going to continue with the next chapter, which is about the cultivation, activation, and expansion of NK cells. Here again, I would like to start off with showing possible challenges that you might face when thinking of culturing NK cells. That's on the one hand, the low expansion rates of NK cells, that you fear the growth of unwanted cells such as T cells or NKT cells, and that you fear that the NK cells lose their cytotoxic activity upon activation and expansion, and that this process might not be reproducible. Now, when looking at the activation and expansion, there are two main products that can help you to do this, and which I want to show also with some IND data, which is on the one hand the NK-MUX medium in combination with the MUX premium grade cytokines, and then after that, additionally, the NK cell activation and expansion kit, which is based on Maxi beads. So first of all, looking at the NK-MUX medium, this medium is by now widely used by NK cell researchers and also CAR NK cell researchers, where you can see here some publications using our medium in combination with cytokines. And just to mention, the medium is also available in GMP grade, so also when the goal is to later transition to the clinical grade setting, this is possible with this medium. So when using the medium, you can, first of all, what I want to mention is that you have to add 5% AB serum to the medium. And what you can, however, when doing this, or when using this medium, you do not need feeder cells. So yes, you have to add the serum, but there's no need for feeder cells. And also the data that is shown here is just with medium and the serum. And here you can see the NK cell, the NK-MUX medium in comparison to the Tex-MEX medium for T cells and to competitor mediums. And you can nicely see that starting from day 7 on, the NK cells nicely expand when using this medium, and that you have really a superior NK cell expansion with this medium. When not culturing already isolated NK cells, but starting off with PBMCs and just culturing the PBMCs with the NK cell medium, you can see here that really, there is a preferential expansion of the NK cells as compared to the NKT and the T cells and also other cell types, which you can see in all these three other media that the NKT and also T cells make a bigger compartment. So it's really leading to preferential growth of NK cells. And also here you can see that this is a killing assay where you can see that the both with the NK-MUX research medium but also with the GMP medium, the target cell killing is effector to target cell, or is dependent on the effector to target cell ratio, and that both isolated NK cells that were expanded in these media keep their cytotoxic function and are able to kill the target cells. And one point that I also want to highlight here is that the premium grade cytokines, in this case we recommend the use of IL-2 and IL-15, that you get a lot specific information about the cytokine activity to really ensure reproducibility and that you use the exact right amount of the cytokines. And both the cytokines and the NK-MAX medium are available in GMP grade. Now, just very briefly, there's a very detailed protocol on how to expand the NK cells with these products, which is covering the different steps of a PBMC and then NK cell isolation, the checking of the NK cell purity by flow cytometry, and then the culture and expansion with the medium and the cytokines, where you find really all the concentrations and the timings that you need. So check this out on our website, or ask, get back to me, or ask your local Wilsoni sales representative to help you if you cannot access this. And then, as second chapter for the NK cell activation, there's the NK cell activation and expansion kit, which is based on MaxiBead particles, which are biotinylated antibodies that bind against NKp46 and CD2. This kit is also very easy to use, as you just have to add the MaxiBeads at day one of your culture. And then this is enough to result in a good NK cell activation and expansion, which you can see here. The blue line are the stimulated NK cells, meaning that the NK cell activation and expansion kit was used, and the black line are NK cells cultured in the NK-MAX medium. Already, as I showed you on the few slides before, the NK-MAX medium results in very good NK cell expansion. Thus, the kit with the NK cell activation and expansion kit only gives you superior cell expansion after 2 weeks. So dependent on what you're interested in, what you want to use, one or the other, or the combination of both might be the best opportunity for you. Then, just as little excursion, because it's a growing field of interest, the CAR NK cells, I would like to talk very briefly about the transduction. And of course, once, in case you're interested in generating CAR NK cells, once you have your NK cells isolated, they expand and they are expanding and they are activated. You of course want to put your gene of interest inside. And how do you do this? We have developed vector fusion, which is a viral transduction enhancer that helps you to get more virus into the cells. It's completely synthetic, non-toxic, and a soluble peptide. And you do not need to think about pre-coating with retronectin or anything like that. So you can just mix your virus with a vector fusion and add it to your solution. So it's also really straightforward protocol. And also vector fusion one is available for research, as research grade and GMP grade. So this is also easily translatable. Here, just some data how the use of vector fusion impacts your transduction and increases the efficiency. So here you can see in the upper row NK92 cells that were transduced, or primary NK cells in the lower row, either non-transduced, only with a virus, or in combination with vector fusion. And here you can nicely see that the usage of vector fusion highly increases the transduction efficiency. And just as final slide regarding this, then after the transduction, of course, you're interested in expanding your CAR NK cells, which what we can show here is that this also works nicely with the NK-MAX medium in combination with IL-2 and IL-15, and that the CAR NK cells also expand after the transduction. And with this, just a very brief additional excursion to pluripotent stem cell culture at maintenance, as CAR NK cells can be generated from different cell sources. So on the one hand, either from primary NK cells, from cell lines such as NK92, but also from, for example, iPSC-derived CAR NK cells can be generated. And due to the fact that this is also of large interest in the community, I just wanted to show here very briefly that for the maintenance and also the storage of a pool of high-quality PSC cells, that here our workflow is summarized. So, firstly, you have the maintenance in culture of the cells, then the passaging, and then in the end, the cryopreservation. And of course, you can characterize your pluripotent stem cells to prove that the good quality of the culture is really maintained. So just to show that regarding all these steps, we have different products that help to, either maintain passage or characterize these cells, and also for cryopreservation. So just to sum up this chapter, I hope I could convince you that the expansion of NK cells is superior with the NK-MAX medium in combination with the cytokines, especially IL-2 and IL-15, and that growth of unwanted cells is minimal, so there's superior growth of NK cells and less growth of T and NKT cells. Also, what I showed data on is that the cytotoxic activity was not impaired upon NK cell culture, that direct target cell killing and also antibody-dependent cellular cytotoxicity is not affected, and that NK cells can kill their target cells. And also, especially with the MAX premium grade cytokines, there's an exact dosage possible, so there is really the chance to standardize your cell culture conditions and to get reproducible results and expansions. So with this, I'm finished with the NK cell culture and just summarizing here the products that can be used for that. And all of them are also available as GMP grade. So then the final chapter is basically focusing on flow cytometry-based analysis of NK cells. On the one hand, phenotyping, but also functional readouts, as most of you probably want to analyze how well the NK cells kill specific target cells. So here again, I'm starting with possible challenges that you might, encounter, which might be, first of all, high background, or that you have to use many isotype controls that, dependent on how experienced you are with flow cytometry and, on the one hand, building up the panel and also the flow analysis afterwards, the staining might be very complex, and also the reproducibility might be questioned by you. So to answer these questions, I will start with introducing, in case you haven't heard of it, the re-affinity antibodies. These are antibodies that are recombinantly generated to really make sure that they lead to reproducible results. They have a mutated Fc region, which is important to know, because by this you can really reduce the background signal and you do not need to do FCR blocking because, yeah, the region is mutated and it's not binding. And they have universal IgG isotype, so you only need one control, which by this you can reduce the complexity of your experiment. This is also shown here. The orange bar or the orange line is showing the staining index with the re-affinity clone in comparison to two further other CD56 stainings with different clones. And where you can nicely see that the staining index is very good. And now I would like to go a little more into detail as compared to the beginning of the presentation, how these killing assays are performed. So here, with regards to the cell separation, we are comparing NK cells that were isolated either with a positive approach, with a straight from microbeads, or with the two untouched approaches. However, what I would like to focus on here in this chapter is that, yeah, the NK cells were isolated with either of this approach and then activated overnight with or by culturing in the NKmax medium, which was supplemented with interleukin-2. And then on the next day, the NK cells were co-cultured with the respective target cells, and in this case, K562 cells. And yeah, a different effector to target cell ratios. And here you can really nicely see that the effector to target cell ratio impacts on the amount of kill target cells. And this was analyzed by flow cytometry as the dead cells were detected by this. Either this can be done by using already labeled target cells. So depending on which target cell line you use, this might be or you might pre-label it, for example, with GFP. Or you can use PI staining and then just analyze your dead cells by gating on the NK cells and the target cells and then looking for dead and viable cells. And the same is true when performing antibody-dependent cellular cytotoxicity assays, where you cultivate your NK cells, which express CD16 on their surface, and especially NKT cells do express only low amounts of CD16. And then the NK cells can recognize the Fc part of the antibody of interest that you're using. In this case, where I show the data later, we used rituximab, and we also used Raji cells as target cells as they do express CD20. And by linking the target cell and the effector cell by the antibody, you can then measure how well this antibody is performing and linking to the NK cells. And in this experimental setup, we used, yeah, we isolated the NK cells, then activated them overnight again in medium supplemented with interleukin-2, and then on the next performed the killing assay. And yeah, this data you saw also already. And here again, the readout is flow-based, meaning that you detect the viable and the dead target cells, and then you can calculate the specific lysis and look at how well the NK cells really kill the target cells. So now, looking at NK cell phenotyping, there are some very nice materials available where we provide you with different panels already established and tested, also by customers, as shown here, and also some gating when you want to analyze the NK cells, so you can look at how this was used. These panels include activation markers as well as maturation markers, so to look at yeah, both these features of NK cells. And also, this is available online on our website. Also, in addition to activation and maturation, you can look, for example, at the chemokine receptor expression. So, also there in the app note, there is a panel described and also staining for many chemokine receptors shown. And just as an example, I picked the staining for four of them, either with unstimulated NK cells or with IL-15 stimulated NK cells, and where you can nicely see a difference between the different chemokine receptors. And also just one further assay that can be done with or where the readout can be done flow-based is the MuxPlex assay, where you can in one sample measure up to 12 human cytokines. So meaning that you can detect these cytokines in the supernatant, so the released cytokines from the NK cells. And this can be done with any standard flow cytometer. However, when using the MuxQuant, this can be automated and be made even easier. However, this is just an add-on. And just to show you how data generated with these kits can look like, you can see here just NK cells that were cultured and NK cells that were cultured in combination with target cells. And here you can nicely see that the NK cells, which were co-cultured with target cells, nicely secreted TNF, GM-CSF, and interferon gamma into the supernatant. Yeah, just to wrap up this chapter about the NK cell analysis, I showed you that the re-affinity antibodies with the mutated Fc region and the universal IgG isotype can be a very helpful and good tool to make your flow analysis easier and more smooth, and also ensure reproducibility. And also, there are a lot of, well, a lot. There are a few app nodes, and also Wilsony Biotech flow panels as protocols, which you can find all on our website to support you with your NK cell phenotyping. So there are already established panels that were used, where also the gating and some examples for stainings are shown. Yeah, and last but not least, this is summarizing what you can do with these products and also as a very important tool, the live dead staining. Yeah, with this, I'm coming to the last very short chapter of the summary, and here I will keep it very brief because I talked about all of this very much in detail. Yeah, just to very briefly highlight and sum up, I could show you that there is no NK cell activation upon positive isolation and neither upon untouched isolation, that you can automate and by this also speed up your isolation and start directly from starting material, that there are a lot of opportunities to improve your NK cell expansion, especially with the medium and the cytokines, and also the NK cell activation and expansion kit can support you. And then finally, looking at the flow cytometry analysis, that you can benefit from the MuxPlex cytokine kits. They are actually, in addition to the kit that I just presented, also there is a cytotoxic T and NK cell cytokine kit, which might be of interest. Yeah, and you can benefit from this as you can with one sample analyze multiple soluble cytokines and also take advantage of the predefined flow panels for NK cell phenotyping. Yes, and with this, in case, yeah, if you want to get any detailed protocol, app note, or yeah, protocol how we performed the ADCC or the killing assay, such as including incubation times and cytokine concentrations, also for the NK cell expansion. Please contact your local Miltony sales consultant, or also I am happy to receive feedback. So with this, also what you can find yourself online already, which includes brochures, app notes, and even more than I mentioned, application protocols, and also even scientific posters from our IND department, also scientific posters focusing on the translational approach, showing that clinical grade NK cells, which were isolated, how they look like. And finally, the MUX handbook, which is which can also be found on our website, where you can find a lot of general information, for example, about NK cell immunology, but also other cell types. So this is really a nice summary. Yeah, and this is just a general disclaimer for us, but for now, I'm happy to take your questions. And I would like to thank you for your attention and curious about your questions. And yeah, in case you need any further information, please contact your local sales representative or me.
Thank you, Julia, for your informative presentation. We will now start the live Q&A portion of the webinar. If you have a question you would like to ask, please do so now. Just click on the Ask a Question box located on the far left of your screen. We'll answer as many of your questions as we have time for. Let's get started. Our first question is, in multiple myeloma, myeloma cells are present in peripheral blood and do express CD56 on their surface. How will you deal with this issue if you want to isolate NK cells from these patients' blood? Okay, I think that Julia had a little bit of trouble with her mute button and is possibly reconnecting. So we will just give her a few minutes. And audience, you've got some great questions and we're excited to answer them for you. So if you will just be patient and hang out with us for a few more minutes. Okay, there. I think that, there, Julia, can you hear me?
Yes.
No, okay, great. Did you hear the question that I read, or would you like me to read it again?
No, I didn't hear it.
Okay. I'm going to read it again, and you can answer. In multiple myeloma, myeloma cells are present in peripheral blood and do express CD56 on their surface. How will you deal with this issue if you want to isolate NK cells from these patients' blood?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for reading out and also for the question. So I have to say I'm not an expert on multiple myeloma, but what I would do in this case is that depending on which other receptors or markers are expressed by the multiple myeloma cells, I would either first isolate the NK cells based on CD56 expression, so positively, and then need to exclude the multiple myeloma cells. So then it would be needed to do a re-ELISA approach to remove the microbeads, or do the NK cell isolation with an untouched approach. And then the question is, depending on which marker is expressed by the multiple myeloma cells, maybe they are excluded with this kit. Then you would really need to get in touch with me and we can discuss this offline, or you do after this kit, you do an depletion with microbeads. For example, I don't know what if multiple myeloma cells express for example CD138 or other markers, that you then in a second step really deplete cells expressing a multiple myeloma specific marker, and then you can be sure that you have the CD56 positive cells, the NK cells, but the other ones excluded.
Thank you, Julia. Mm-hmm. Our next question, do you have any experience in NK isolation from the tumor microenvironment?
Also thanks for that question. So far, at least my personal experience is mainly on human peripheral NK cells and not from NK cells isolated from the tumor microenvironment. But I know that Mosony Biotech offers several kits and products that are made to dissociate tumor tissue and also other, in general, other tissue samples. So you can do that automated with a GentleMax and the in combination with the tissue dissociation kits. And then after that, when you have your single cell suspension from the tissue or the tumor, you can then do an NK cell isolation. Or also then, dependent on if you're interested in the tumor cells, also a tumor cell isolation.
Thank you, Julia. Our next question is, what are the main differences between the use of microbeads and the FACS cell sorter?
Yeah, also thanks for that one. Yeah, there are a few differences. So on the first hand, labeling with microbeads and with fluorochromes is one, yeah, makes one big difference. So the microbeads are biodegradable and they have a cell-friendly hydrophilic coating. And with in combination with the microbeads and the columns that we use for cell separation, we really ensure that by increasing the magnetic force with the columns, that you need minimal labeling with the microbeads on the cell surface. So the cells are really minimally labeled and thus can also be then, even without removing the microbeads from the surface, be still used for downstream applications. So, and on the other hand, so this is the one huge advantage, and also what I would like to mention is that also going via the column, where for us it looks like there's no space for the cells, but as the cells are so tiny, there's actually quite some space for the cells to move through the column. In contrast to the FACS cell sorting, it has much less physical stress because it doesn't have the high pressure as the normal droplet sorters have it.
Thank you, Julia. Our next question here is, what is the best gating strategy?
Ooh, yeah, that, of course, always depends what you want to look at in the end. So what you definitely need to do if you work with human NK cells is, depends how many colors you have. So firstly, gating on CD45 positive, excluding dead cells and doublets. And then what is really, really essential is to gate on CD3 negative to exclude all the all the T cells and NKT cells, and then gate on the CD56 positive, but the ones definitely being CD3 negative. And then, yeah, further after identification of the NK cells, it then depends what you are interested in, and which markers to look at. And that's then also, I would say, personal experience, which markers you would plot next to each other, as there are always some combinations which work very, very good. But I think this you can also find in publications nicely. But I think for identification, it's necessarily CD3 negative, CD56 positive.
Thank you, Julia. Okay, this is a kind of a three-parter. The phenotyping of CD107A degranulation marker correlates with the NK cell cytotoxicity, and there's a question mark. So which of both is the best assay? And what about live-dead staining in cytotoxicity assay?
Yeah, so it's difficult to say what's the best assay, so it always depends what you're interested in, what your stimulation is, what because it's a different readout. So CD107A as marker for degranulation of the NK cells is really tells you how much the NK cells degranulate and release CD100 and have CD107A on the receptor surface. The cytotoxicity in the way that I just stated is looking at the live dead frequency. So how many of the target cells were killed by the NK cells. Therefore, of course, that is the connection to the live dead staining, which can be done in different ways. So for example, with propionic iodide, but also you can use, for example, GFP labeled target cells or something like that. So there are different ways of looking at the live dead cells. Just important to really check that it's the target cells you're looking at and not the effector cells. But yeah, it's a different readout. So I think dependent on what you're interested in, and if you don't know which one is better for the assay that you use, I would maybe have a look at both because it can also differ.
Thank you, Julia. Next question, is Miltenyi Biotech working toward a serum-free media option for NK cells?
Yeah, very, very good question. Yeah, so far what is on the market is the research and the GMP NKmax medium, which needs the addition of 5% AB serum. And yeah, Miltenyi Biotech is working on a serum-free solution, but it will still take some time until that is available. The serum is needed because, yeah, the NK cells need something to feed on. So that is also why the expansion rates are so nice. So, yeah, there is work going on. But, yeah, I can unfortunately not say when this will be available. But, yeah, it's of huge interest in general. Yeah.
All right. Thanks again, Julia. Next question here is a three-parter. Let's see. What is the difference in NK cells expanded from PBMC versus purified NK cells? How long do these expanded cells survive in vitro? And how is the CD16 expression on expanded NK cells?
Yep. I just try to answer them all in one. So the difference, let's say it like this, the NK cells expand even faster when cultivating in PBMCs instead of purified NK cells, which is because they have the interaction with other cell types. They are cytokines released by other cell types and everything like this. So there's more support, which leads to a higher expansion rate. But of course, dependent on what your downstream assay is and whether you need pure NK cells or not, I would use the one or the other approach. So it really depends what you want to do afterwards with your NK cells. Other than that, you have the different composition of other cells, there is no difference. The data that I think I showed was 14 days, but we also expand the cells for 3 weeks, which also works nicely, also only with the NKmax medium and without the MaxiBeads, where I showed 21-day data. So that works for sure. And also, I think it should be fine with 4 weeks. But yeah, NK cells are really, really tricky. So they like to be treated well. We have a very detailed protocol, application protocol on our website, where we, especially for the first days, where they are really, really difficult to expand and to treat, a detailed protocol, what to do when and how to do it. So you really need to be careful when taking care of NK cells. But I think when you have a good culture set up, it shouldn't be a problem. And CD16 expression, I would need to look up. So maybe if you can, I don't know who asked this question, maybe if you can shoot me an email and then I can answer that later on. I would rather say they are positive or upregulating CD16, but I'm not sure. So I would like to follow that one up.
Sure, absolutely. We have time for one more question. What's the main motive of isolating the NK cells?
Yeah, so I think when you, depending on your downstream assay, if you really need pure NK cells, you would need to isolate them. Other than that, you can also expand them or culture them with the other cells together. But I think especially when moving to the field of CAR NK cell engineering, you want to have pure NK cells, because otherwise you need, for example, you don't have high enough concentration of NK cells for the transduction. So it really depends on your downstream assay whether it's worth it or not. If you, for example, want to do an ADCC or other killing assay and really only want to have your NK cells in, then it's worth it to separate them. But the assay itself works also if you use PBMCs. However, then you also have other target cells in. So that really depends on your readout and your goal. If you have a good flow panel, you can also gate then afterwards on the NK cells and also identify the other cells which might interfere and gate them out.
Thank you, Julia. Yeah. Are you finished? I'm sorry, did I interrupt? Okay, thank you, Julia. Do you have any final comments for our audience?
No, I would just like to thank you also for the nice interaction and the many questions. And if there are any additional questions that come up in your mind now afterwards, please feel free to contact either your local Milton Biotech representative or me directly. And also, if you contact your local person, they will come back to me. So no worries about that. And then I can answer that later on. And thank you for your attention and staying with me for this hour.
Thank you again to our speaker, Julia Hengst, for your time today and for your important research. We would also like to thank LabRoots and our sponsor, Milton Biotech, for underwriting today's educational webcast. Before we go, I'd like to thank the audience for joining us today and for their interesting questions. Questions we did not have time for today and those submitted during the on-demand period will be addressed by the speaker via the contact information you provided at the time of registration. This webcast can be viewed on demand. LabRoots will alert you via email when it's available for replay. We encourage you to share that email with your colleagues who may have missed today's live event. Until next time, goodbye.